which we were worked on in Berlin, in the Berlin years.
Well, my interest was primarily focused on the kidney, orientated on the simple question, what happens, where does it happen, and how does it take place?
Simple questions,
yeah,
but sometimes difficult answers.
Yeah, that is true. Our approach was comprehensive. First, a physiological one, by applying micropuncture, microperfusion, and microanalysis. A biophysical one, this is by quantifying fluxes and the conjugated driving forces, and by discriminating passive, primary active, and secondary active transport processes. And third, by analyzing chemical events involved in transmembrane transport. In detail, we proceeded from simple microperfusion of the tubules to double microperfusion, where we could change the solutions outside and inside independently. And later in Frankfurt, we did transport measurements on isocell site, and I will come to this topic later.
Later. Over the years, several papers focused on the proximal tubule of the kidney. Could you summarize what has been achieved in these studies in Berlin, in the Berlin years?
Well, with free flow micropuncture of the proximal tubules, we analyzed the transport of sodium ions together with Mike Kashkarian and Karl Gottschalk, the transport of potassium together with Donald Marsh and Gerhard Rumrich, and the transport of calcium together with Anselm Frick. In the following years, we measured the water permeability of cortical renal tubules and evaluated the permeability and reflection coefficient of different electrolytes and non-electrolytes. This was done together with Eberhard Fronder and Karl Baumann. And in 1963, I wrote together with Donald Marsh the chapter Kidney Water and Electrolyte in Annual Review of Physiology. But from the water permeability, I will show some pictures. And the first picture here shows the microperfusion, a tubule, and then at A, see on the surface, the tubule was opened and blocked by oil, and then C was the infusion site and D the withdrawal site, and the perfusion was done with the high precise working microperfusion pump. And the lower part shows you the data for the measurement of water permeability. And so open, well, and we perfused hypo or hypertonic solutions and looked how fast the approach to isotonicity was with the distance of the perfused segment. And you could see the open circles are when the perfusion was done with hypertonic solution, and the closed circles were done with the perfusion of hypertonic solution. And you can see that in the proximal, and this data, the dots and the points are from animals in water diaries. And you could see that osmotic approach in the proximal tubule were the same as an antidiuresis, and antidiuresis as a shattered area. And in the lower curve shows the approach in water diuresis, the dots, and they were much lower, almost no approach to isotonicity as the isotonicity approach in antidiuresis, and this is a shattered area. And at the same time, we measured also the reflection coefficient perfusing short segments of the proximal tubule with solutions, with solutions only of one substance, but with different osmolality. And we determined by interpolation, the concentration of the substance where no net water flux takes place. And here the data are different experiments all done with raffinose, and you could see that no water flux occurred when the perfusate has 200 millimole raffinose. The isotonic concentration was not only determined by raffinose, but also by erythrol, glycerol, and urea, and the reflection coefficient was evaluated by these data.
Well, aside from renal epithelia, as we have already discussed, you and your co-workers also studied other epithelial membranes. Could you briefly go into that?
Yes. Since we had the necessary arsenal of techniques, we made also micropuncture experiments on sweat glands and salivary glands. The sweat gland micropuncture was done by Erin Schulz, and the salivary gland micropuncture was done by Martinez and John Young. Here I should mention Eberhard Frönter, which you see on the next photo, and Irene Schulz, which you see in the next picture together with Klaus Thurau. And both Eberhard Frönter and Irene Schulz were the first who recognized that the defect in mucoviscidosis sweat glands is caused by a reduced permeability of the sweat gland duct for chloride ions. This knowledge led finally to CFTR, cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. Irene Schulz was also the first who showed in 1983, together with Mike Berridge, that IP3 is the important second messenger who liberates calcium from the endoplasmatic reticulum. And the next figure shows you the data we gained in 1985-1986 on proximal tubules, and you can see in permeabilized proximal tubules the uptake of sodium, then the calibration with calcium, then the application of angiotensin 2, and you could see that during angiotensin 2 the concentration of calcium is increased, and the same is shown when IP3 is applied. And this is the first indication that IP3 worked as second messenger of angiotensin in the proximal renal tube.
Well, Karl, from Berlin, you eventually moved to the Max Planck Institute of Biophysics here in Frankfurt. What was your motivation at that time to move from Berlin to Frankfurt?
Well, I really liked to live in Berlin and was happy with the institute despite the beginning of the student revolt, which did not touch me very much. But the offer of the Max Planck Society was unique, to go to Frankfurt and to collaborate with Reinhard Schlögl, who was already director at the Institute, and with Fritz Sauer, a gifted theoretical physicist. And later came Hermann Passow, which is shown in the next slide, as third director. Hermann Passow is known for his work on chloride bicarbonate exchange, the band 3 protein in red blood cells.
Well, now let us concentrate on your time in Frankfurt. Can you give us a brief overview of over the main topics you concentrated on, over the techniques you have applied, and over some of your results?
Well, at that time we found, as shown in the next slide, that bicarbonate or related buffer in the glycodiazin, sulfamerosin, and butyrate are necessary for proximal sodium and chloride in water reabsorption. This showed clearly that the reabsorption of bicarbonate or related buffers in concert with non-ionic diffusion is the principal event in proximal electrolyte and water reabsorption, and pointed clearly to the sodium-hydrogen exchange in the luminal membrane of the proximal tubule. And the figures show clearly that, that these buffers really could replace the buffer glycodiazin sulfamyrazine buffers with a proper pK value could replace the bicarbonate buffer. Now, the proposal that sodium-hydrogen exchange is the important part for proximal reabsorption was later documented in brush border membrane vesicles by Heini Murer and Rolf Kinnen. Mm-hmm. And the next figure show Heini Murer, who not only showed the first time the sodium H exchange, he later cloned the phosphate transporters, the sulfate transporters in the proximal tubule. He got the Homer Smith Award. He is member of the Academia Europea. And the next picture shows Rolf Kinnen. Rolf worked together, Rolf and Heini were working together. Rolf did much work on the co-transport of sodium with glucose, amino acids, and other solutes. He later was the full professor at the Albert Einstein University in New York, and is now director of the Max Planck Institute of Molecular Physiology in Dortmund. Mm-hmm. Rolf is recipient of the Robert Pitts Lecture and the Homer Smith Award. One of the great topics was the evaluation of the paracellular pathway and the discrimination of leaky and tight epithelia. This was done by Eberhard Frömmter, the figure of Eberhard I showed you already, and in connection with Chaired Diamond. And also from that time I have a picture which showed Chaired Diamond and also George Sachs, who worked on stimulus secretion coupling of gastric glands and was for a longer time worked in our institute. And on the same picture is Ole Pedersen, who worked on stimulus secretion coupling in the exocrine glands, and he was on the board of trustees and advisors of our institute for many years. And the next photograph shows Fritz Sauer together with Dan Torstensen, who was later dean of the medical faculty at Harvard, and he was for a visit in our institute. And Fritz Sauer provided us with the equations to quantitate tubular transport across the proximal tubules in terms of active and passive transport rate and the conjugated driving forces. This is the transtubular electrical potential difference and solvent drag. And the next figure shows a front page of the main publication, reflection coefficient and permeability of urea in the proximal convolution of the red kidney with application of non-equilibrium thermodynamics for a multi-component system with active transport and so on. Amongst the authors is Fritz Sauer. And the next picture shows you the Fritz Sauer equation of transtubular transport. He divided the net transport in the passive and the active. His formula divides the net transport in the passive and an active term. And the passive term is again divided by solvent drag and diffusion. And such solvent drag is 1 minus the reflection coefficient, the mean concentrations, and is determined by the water flux. And the passive, the diffusion, is proportional to the permeability, and the electrochemical gradient, the concentration difference, and the electrical potential. And by rearranging this curve, one comes to formulation which made it possible to calculate the reflection coefficients and the active and passive part just by measuring water flux, concentration difference, permeability, and the electrical potential difference. And then, of course, it was also possible to determine the active part, which is proportional to the permeability and the driving force, the electrochemical potential difference. And if the permeability, you take the permeability as constant, then it is the static head concentration, the maximal driving force, which tells you then what part is caused by active transport. Now, the next figures show how the permeability are determined. This is the permeability measurements for urea in the first figure. And the next figure is the plot of the transtubular urea flux against the transtubular urea gradient. And you could see that the curve is going to the origin, which means urea is transported passively. And if you analyze it in detail, you could say that the passive part is half by solvent drag and half by diffusion. And the next slide gives you the determination of the sodium permeability, which of course is an important point that exact calculations could be made. And the next slide shows you the plot of the transport on the abscissa against the driving force on the ordinate. And you could see with chloride, with zero driving force, the net transport is zero. With sodium, with zero driving force, there is still transport. This is the active transport. And the same holds for bicarbonate. And from the slope and the permeability, you could evaluate the reflection coefficient for chloride and sodium. And then in the next graph, I have plotted the active and passive part for sodium, chloride, and bicarbonate, calcium, and urea transport in the proximal tubule. And as you can see, the net sodium transport in the intact tubule is only 30% active and 2/3 passive. And half of this passive part is solvent drag, half is diffusion. Chloride transport is almost completely passive. Bicarbonate transport is active and passive backflux. Calcium, on a scale, calcium behaves similar as sodium, and urea again as chloride, almost all transport is passive. And the next slide shows you that you really, on top of active transport, you can impose a passive component, and this even for glucose. And this shows that with the transtubular glucose concentration difference, you could get a parallel deviation, which you got when no glucose transport is present, when the glucose transport is blocked by fluorine. In 1973, I wrote together with Fritz Sauer's Handbook of Renal Physiology in the chapter Permeability Characteristics of the Mammalian Nephron. In the same year came Ken Sosato in our institute, and we made an interesting observation. Namely, that serum injected into the proximal tubular lumen destroys the brush border caused by complement activation. The pathophysiological implication of this effect is still open. This means if from the same individual blood came with the complement came into the tubular lumen, they destroy, is activated and destroys the brush border. And the next figure shows Ken Sosato. He is the leading sweat gland physiologist.
Now
at all. And is in the Human Gene Therapy Research Institute in Des Moines in Iowa, USA. Now, using the pump and leak concept, we showed clearly in the 70s that the measurements of the static head concentration difference, this is the concentration difference of a substance at zero net flux, is a good measure for active transport rate. I showed you this with the Fritz Sauer equation.
Yes.
With this method, we could measure the kinetics of the different active transport mechanism in C2 and determine the factors on which they depend. For instance, the sodium concentration, the specificity, and the sensitivity against inhibitor. And I have some slides. This shows the static head, the dependence of static head of alpha-methyl-D-glycoside, glucose analog, with different outside concentration, and from since different outside concentration against the sodium concentration plotted, the delta C of the sodium concentration, and from this curve, you could measure Km values and Vmax values. And in this case, as with ornithine, which we showed it, was shown that the sodium concentration changes only the Km values and lets the Vmax values unchanged. And then we did also delta C static head measurements with the buffer glycotyrosine. And you could see that the glycotyrosine static head concentration difference depends on sodium. You could replace sodium by choline or lithium, you get the same decline of the active transport rate with lowering the sodium concentration. Well, and all these results were also considered by Heini Murer and Rolf Kinne, who did similar experiments on brush border membranes, and by Eberhard Fremder, who did electrical measurements. So we had in parallel transport measurements on the kidney in situ, electrical measurements on the kidney in situ, and proximal tubules in situ, and then also the measurements with the transport with the vesicles from the luminal cell side. In 1979, Eberhard Fremder, Heini Murer and I wrote a short review entitled Principles of Epithelial Transport in Kidney and in Intestine. And we realized, of course, that many of the sodium-dependent transport processes were also present in the
small intestine.
In the small intestine, jawohl. Yeah, in the early 80s then, we studied the static head of sodium on active transport of sulfate, on active transport of taurocholate, together with Fred Wilson and Gerhard Burkert, and the bidirectional transport of thiosulfate. So far, we dealt with transtubular transport. But our intention was to perform short-term transport measurements on isocell side of the proximal tubule. This was no problem for measuring the outflux from the lumen, the outflux of substrate from the lumen. But it was a problem for the flux measurements on the contraluminal substrate. So I was in this situation inspired by a poster of Gerhard Malnig at the International Congress of Nephrology in Athens, where he showed that after clamping the renal artery, the proximal tubules collapse within a few seconds. Then it is possible to inject test solutions into peritubular capillaries and to measure disappearance of the test substrate caused by the peritubular influx into the tubular substrate. We adapted this method for our purpose and studied kinetics effects and the effect of auxiliary and inhibitory substances, and especially the specificity of the different transport processes. On this place, I have, I should first show the results we get from the lumen for lactate transport. And as you can see, I have plotted the aliphatic fatty acids, substituted aliphatic acid, which inhibit transport, which interact on part A, and inhibitory substance, which did not, aliphatic substance substitutes, which did not inhibit part B. Then we did the same for aromatic, for substituted benzoates, those substrates which inhibit lactate transport and those which did not inhibit lactate transport. And here we found, for the first time, that the inhibitory potency of a substrate depends on the acidity of the compound. And this acidity is related to the Hammett constant. And the Hammett constant indicates how much a substitute changes the pKa value at the carboxylate. And as you can see here, see with positive Hammett constants, we saw an inhibition. These are the
triangles.
Just the closed points, the points at the right. And with the negative values, we saw almost no or a very small inhibition. Now, at that time, my collaborator, my main collaborator, was Günter Fritsch. Of course, beside Gerhard Rumrich, who did the micropuncture work. Günter Fritsch, you see him on the, on the next picture, is a theoretical physicist. And he came in the early 80s to us. Günter Fritsch was in the opposition in Leipzig against the communistic regime in the DDR. And he was pressed to become a spy against Karl Friedrich von Weizsäcker, but he refused. And for this, they finally imprisoned him. He got many years in prison, and about his time in East German prison, he wrote a book with the title Face Toward the Wall. And after Günter Fritsch came to us, we adapted the idea of Malnig, which you could see in the next slide, see decrease at the extracellular fluid of para-aminohyperase, which flows into the cell. And you see here the percent decrease at different starting concentration. Mm-hmm. And by this data, of course, we could measure CKM and Vmax of the different substrates, and we could also measure, of course, the maximal velocity and also inhibition by substance which inhibited the transport. We did the contralumin influx measurements with paraaminohiparate, with decarboxylates, and with sulfate oxalate. And we also investigated the transport of organic cations at the contraluminal cell site. And the table shows the different substrates and groups of substrates, homologous series of substrates, which we investigated for the anion transporters and also for the cation transporters. And you can see that different transporters interacted with all three transporters. For instance, decarboxylate interact also not only with the decarboxylate transporter, but also with the paraaminohiparate and the sulfate transporter. Substituted benzene analogs also interact with all three transporters. And the same holds with phenolphthalates, the same holds with fluorescein and so on. And we tested beta-lactam antibiotics, sulfamyl compounds and diuretics. We tested dipeptides. We tested glutathione conjugates, cysteine conjugates, eicosanoids, very important, corticosteroids and bile acids. And in the last column, you have substrates which we tested for the organic cation transport. So different groups, the piperidines, piperoxines, quinolidines, and so on, guanidines, dipeptides, and we had all from all groups different different analogs which we tested for the different transporters.
Well, is it correct to state that in recent years you have mainly been centering on the interrelationship between substrate structure and transporters of substrates which undergo proximal reabsorption in the kidney? Could you elaborate on that and give us the general principles of interaction of the various compounds, the anions, the cations, the bi- and polysubstrates which you studied?
We investigated the contraluminal transport mechanism for organic anions, as already mentioned, and the contraluminal transport mechanism for organic cations with N-methylnicotinamide as test substrate or tetraethylammonium as test substrate. And we tested also the luminal H-ion organic cation exchanger and with methylphenylpyridinium, MPP, as test substrate and the luminal choline transporter, with choline. From more than 1,000 substrates tested, we can say that the factors which determine the specificity of substrates of these transporters are the same. Namely, the size, first important is the size of the molecules and the distance of the interacting group. And this is nicely shown in the first graph, which I show you here. Here we have a plot of the homologous series of decarboxylates against the inhibitory potency against the paraaminohiparate transport, the succinate transport, and sulfate transport. And you could see that only oxalate, the second, inhibits the transport of sulfate, not the other transport processes. And with the next, malonate does not interact at all with the three transporters. But then came succinate. And with succinate, you see that it has already the maximal inhibitory effect against the succinate, but only a low effect on paraaminohiparate. And later, when we go to glutarate, adipate, and so on, you could see that the transport on succinate, the inhibitory effect on succinate declines when the substrate, the molecule becomes larger. But with the paraaminohiparate, the inhibitory potency stays. And from all these many substrates, we could evaluate a graph which shows you for each transporter how this, what distance of the charges are important. And you could see that the sulfate transporter likes two charges, one ionic charge and possibly another ionic charge, or also a partly electronegative charge with a distance of 3 to 6 angstroms. The decarboxylate transporter likes substrates with two negative charge groups at a distance of 5 to 6 angstroms. And the paraminohippurate, you know, he is happy with one electronegative ionic charge, or one with one partially electronegative charge, and then of course a hydrophobic moiety, and the hydrophobic moiety is shown by the shaded area. But the paraminohippurate transport takes also substrates with two charges, with two ionic and also with two partially electronegative charges. And the second fact which determines the interaction with the different transporters is the hydrophobicity. And in the next slide you could see the hydrophobicity of dipeptides on the Nosaki scale. And with increased hydrophobicity, the Ki against paraminohippurate decreases. This means the affinity increases. The same is here shown for phenylalkylamines, for catecholamines and related substrates. And log octanol is also a measure of hydrophobicity. And you could see that with increasing log octanol values, the Ki against the contraluminal MEN transporter decreases, which means the affinity increases. Well, the third determinant is the acidity or the basicity. Acidity for the anion transporter, basicity for the cation transporter. I have shown you this already with the Hammett constant on the lactate transport, luminal lactate transport. This is now contraluminal paraaminohippurate transport. And here is a plot of pKa values. And you could see that with decreasing pKa values, this means with decreasing, with increasing acidity, the Ki of paraaminohippurate decreases, this means affinity increases. Again, with increasing acidity of the substituted phenols, the affinity increases. Just contrary is the situation with heterocyclic pyridine, quinoline, and so on compounds. And you could see that in this case, with increasing basicity, increasing pKa values, the Ki decreases, which means that with increasing pKa values of organic cations, the affinity increases. And then the most important thing, I think, is that the hydrogen bonds play an important role. And as you know, we have seen that the organic anion and cation transporter does not see the degree of ionization. This means the substrate is bound with hydrogen bond and is not with electrostatic interaction. And this is documented already, the importance of the hydrogen bonds on the next slide, which shows you of a lot of primary, secondary amines, tertiary amines, piperacines, and benzodiazepines. And you would say, say all interact, of course, with the organic cation transporter, but here they interact with the paramine hyperhidrate transporter. And as more, this means there are B-substrates, substrates which interact with cation transporters, interact also with anion transporters. And you see with the increasing number of high bond acceptors, the Ka value of paramine hyperhidrate decreases, this means affinity increases. Now on this trail we came also to the statement that many, many substrates, and especially drugs and chemicals, say interact as B-substrates. This means substances which interact with the organic anion and the organic cation transport system. And here in this graph I have plotted amines, piperidines, piperacines, amidazoles, quinidine, and so on. And then also dipeptide, cephalosporins, quinoline, gyrase inhibitors.
Many others, yes.
Non-ionic steroid hormones, cyclophosphamines. And finally, we have a graph here which shows you in 1 and 2 the prerequisite for the interaction with the paramine hyperhidrate transporter. You need a hydrophobic core or one ionic negative or partial negative ion. And mostly these are oxygen atoms. Now, for the organic cation transporter, you need a hydrophobic core again, and either an electropositive charge or a partial electropositive, which means an electron donating group. And then if you combine that, then you getting B substrates, which you
yes,
see
I
here.
Guess we have to refer to the original
on
paper,
the
yeah.
graph. Well, and the interesting point we had this data about cations and anions, the interesting point was that then later our colleagues cloned the transporter. So this is a picture of Hermann Köpsel. He cloned in 1993-94, he cloned the organic cation transporter at the contraluminal cell site. And last year, in 1997, Gerhard Burkhardt, next picture, shows him with Wilfried Haase, the electron microscopy in our institute. Gerhard Burkhardt cloned the organic anion transporter, the paramine hyperhidrate transporter, from the flounder kidney. And, well, it was very interesting when I knew from Gerhard Burkhardt that his transporter, his organic and paramine hyperhidrate transporter is related to Hermann Köpsel's organic cation transporters. And when they met the first time, I was together with him. And Gerhard Burkhardt told to Hermann Köpsel, Hermann, my anion transporter is related to another transporter. What do you mean with what transporter is related? And Hermann Köpsel said, with my transporter? And he said, yes. And here you have the bridge between B substrate and this important group of transporters, who finally transport all chemicals and all substances which chemical industry and pharmaceutical industry produce, they belong to the same family of transporters. Mm-hmm. Our studies on the renal transport of organic anions and organic cations are compiled in a review which appeared in 1997 in the Journal of Membrane Biology. Now, while our, to some degree, reductionistic approach, which was, however, all the time performed on the intact tubules in situ, was very satisfactory to me, I was also interested to see whether the interaction of substrates on the cellular level could be demonstrated in the intact kidney in situ. This is also in the integrated system. For this, we make shot injections of fluorescent substrates of paraaminohiporate or the cationic of the paraaminohiporate like sulfafluorescein or the cationic dye asp amino diaminostyryl methylpyridinium. And in rats, and we measured the urinary excretion pattern of these dyes relative to inulin. And simultaneously, we measured the substrate fluorescence at the surface of the kidney. And as you can see from the next slide, co-injection of glutarate increased the substrate specificity of sulfafluorescein in the tissue, and also the excretion. This is a shadowed area of sulfafluorescein was increased. The same we made with the cationic substrate. And as you can see, the simultaneous injection of amylaride increased the concentration of this dye in the tissue. And as you can see, the excretion, the shattered area, the excretion pattern is diminished. And in this case, it means that the substrate is filtered and reabsorbed. And by amylaride, the reabsorption is increased and the intracellular concentration is augmented. This means it's a countercurrent system at the luminal cell site. In the last years, I concentrated on the question with what transport processes interact different groups of drugs, for instance, anti-inflammatory drugs, the conjugates, morphine analogs, diuretics, dephosphonates, and uricosuric drugs. This effort resulted in a list of over 250 drugs which will appear in the book Membrane Transporters as Drug Targets, which edited by Amidon and Savi in Plenum Press, and which will appear end of this year. Of great interest to me was the question, how metabolic transformation does change the affinity of substrates against different transporters? And this is demonstrated in the last three, in the next three tables. And you could see that conjugation with glutathione and processing led to an increase of affinity against the paraaminohiparate transporter. And you can also see that conjugation of different amino acids led to an increase when they are of affinity when they are benzylated. And when they are methylated as N-methyl compounds, then the changes in transporter. This N-methyl glutamate, N-methyl arginine, N-methyl glutathione, they interact just with the organic cation transporter. Now, very important is also the conjugation with sulfate and glucuronide for the excretion of many xenobiotics. And as you can see, many substrates, in the next table, substrates which do not interact at all after sulfation or glucuronidation, say interact with the paraaminohiparate or the sulfate transporter. And our last work was done on the transport of paraaminohiparate through the luminal cell site. And this is very difficult because the transport, a transport of paraaminohiparate out of the lumen hardly did occur. So we had to test the transport from the cell into the lumen. And in this experiment, the cell was loaded with for a short time with para-aminohiperate, and we measured the efflux into the lumen. And as we can see, especially the uricosuric substrates inhibit this efflux. And this means that somehow these uricosuric substrates have an affinity to this para-aminohiperate efflux agency, and the problem is whether the para-aminohiperate efflux is somehow linked with the urate transport, which we have not yet determined. And
well, I should like to come to co-workers again. As far as I can see, you had an incredible ability to attract young and enthusiastic people from here and abroad, whom you trained and with whom you cooperated over the years. We have compiled the names, I guess, and have obtained a very impressive list. Would you like to show the list?
Well, here we have the list. As collaborators in my group are listed Gerhard Rumrich, Ulis Baldamus, Papavasiliou, Glöss, Radke, Sato, Sauer, Capasso, Sheridan, Cherry, Fritsch, Lang, Fasold and Atoshi, Ammer, David and Pietruk. Now, the group leaders at the time in Frankfurt were Eberhard Frömter, I showed you already pictures, Rolf Kinne, Karl Baumann, Irene Schulz, Lothar Thomas, Heini Mure, Hermann Köpsel, Gerhard Burkhardt, Rainer Greger, Heinz Gögelein, Wilfried Haase and Wilfried Siffert. And I will show you some pictures. The next picture shows Baldamus, Ulich and Brandis and Stolde, who were already in Berlin with us. And the next picture shows Arkos Cherry. Arkos Cherry was here in Frankfurt with us and worked very effective on the problems of reabsorption out, sodium chloride reabsorption out of the proximal tubule. And Arkos Cherry saved my life. In 1994, I was to symposium in Bowral near Sydney. And in the morning, I had breakfast with Arkos Cherry. And we drank several cups of coffee, and suddenly I became cardiac tachycardia. And Arkos Cherry instantaneously ordered defibrillation, and this actually saved my life. Now the next picture shows you our micropuncture experiments, Gerhard Rumrich and Papavasiliou and Sonja Glöss, who did most of the analytical work. And then the young ladies who make the doctor thesis with us, Ute Ammer and Christina David. And so, also picture from the group leader, this is Lothar Thomas. He worked in the early 70s on affinity labeling of the glucose transporter, and he's today a leading clinical chemist in Germany. And the next picture shows you Rainer Greger. Rainer Greger was he improved the microperfusion of isolated tubules. He demonstrated sodium chloride by potassium transport in the thick ascending limb. He analyzed the secretory transport steps in shark, rectal glands and colonic grips. He is recipient of the Adolf Fick Prize. He is member of the Leopoldina and the Academie Europae. And he is a permanent friend and supporter of our group. And the next picture shows Heinz Gögelein. Heinz Gögelein worked with Rainer Greger. He introduced the patch clamp techniques in our institute. And he is the scientist with the Höchst Marion Rossell with a pharmaceutical company.
Well, to sum that up, many of them hold chairs, directorships, or leading positions in the industry. Many have contributed importantly, as you indicated, to progress of nephrology. I think you should also show us a list of those scientists who worked for a longer time in your institute in Frankfurt.
Well, on your request, I prepared a list. And this shows the collaborators in Frankfurt who entered nephrology. Knauf, Schlatter, Witzemann, Birk, Krippenheuer, Zeusen. And then four guests who worked for a longer time in our institute. And a lot are from the USA, Irving Schwarz, Ernst Wright, Charles Sachs, Kenzo Sato, Adil Jammu, Ulrich Hopfer, Peter Frohner, Donald Dietrich, Jun Chan, Bob Faust, Patricio Silva, Ilse Duce, Jill Eveloff, Fred Wilson, Heiner Velasquez, Professor Lim, John Hazlett, Catherine Fuller, and Ghana Party. And then we have guests from Poland, from Japan, Croatia, Italia, Latin America, Australia, France, Czechoslovakia, Switzerland, Russia, Bulgaria, England, Hungary,
yes,
and Belgium. And many of them, especially those from Switzerland, are still working very hard in the renal field and are very successful.
I guess we are referred to the table in original form.
Yeah, yeah. And then I really should show you some of the close friends with whom we were in contact all the time. And in this list I have Maurice Perk, a picture of him you will see here. Then on the next picture you see Floyd Rector together with Tom Andrioli, Barry Brenner and Stefan Silvernagel, and then also a picture which shows Gerhard Diebisch, Donald Seldin, then Ole Petersen, and François Roche Ramel, and others.
Yeah. Well, I think at this point it is highly appropriate to mention your wife. When we talk about the many guests whom you have in your department, we have to remember your wife, who not only supported your work in the background and cared for your health, but who also was a brilliant host to all of your guests, and thus contributed significantly to the friendly atmosphere which developed, and which you still keep on over the years, between so many, particularly foreign scientists, in your institute and your family. I think I have a few more final questions. I like to touch briefly on merits. I know it's how difficult it is to talk of one's own merits, but you have been working successfully, and therefore it is inescapable that you received honors and recognitions. Could you just list a few which you enjoyed particularly?
Well, first I am thankful for all acknowledgments,
yes, of course,
I received. But since I felt at home in nephrology, I'm especially satisfied by honors I received in that field, the Holmes Miss Award, the Richards Award, the Franz Wolhard Medal, and the Jakob Händler Medal, and the honorary membership of Nephrological Society of Australia, Germany and Poland. Of course, I'm also very proud about the honorary membership of the American Physiological Society, the German Physiological Society, the Hungarian Physiological Society, and the membership in the Akademie Europäische Akademie, in the Akademie Leopoldina, in the Akademie Europäische, in the Russian and Polish Academy of Science. Emotionally, the honorary degree of the medical faculties of Marburg, Berlin and Zurich means very much to me, since it strengthens my ties to these universities where I worked or where now my co-workers work.
Well, may I ask you finally, what have been or has been your main scientific interests since you retired?
You mean since I'm out of the laboratory?
Yes.
Yes.
This officially retired, I should say.
This is 2 years by now, and my main interest is the cloning and the renal of the renal transporters, especially those for organic anions and cations cell localization, cell function in kidney and liver, and cell knockout. Then I hope for progress in X-ray crystallography in the group of Michel, who is now the director in our institute. And my former collaborator, Günter Fritsch, works with Fritsch Michel, and I hope that finally they will get crystals and show us where the binding sites of the substrates are located within the transporters, the substrates which we investigated, and possibly how the substrates are translocated through the membrane.
Okay, and to round that up, what have been your interests outside the field of range physiology? Well, some of your interests.
Yes. Well, as you know, I have many interests. Among those are history and historical context of art, literature, and music. And I think that only in the historical context you get access to these very important attitudes to life.
Okay, then I think I should really ask one more final question. Could you give us your opinion as to how renal physiology will progress in the future? What are the most important challenges and how should they be met?
Well, I think that renal physiology will proceed in parallel with molecular cell biology. With some patients, one will finally find out how the different events are integrated in the function of the cell and in the function of the whole kidney.
Well, with that, Carl, I think we have come to the end of this interview. I should like to thank you very much, and I should also like to thank Mr. Christian, who has been recording this memorable event on September 8, I should add, 1998.